Reginald, I can't believe we just watched that movie.
I know, it was Cecil. It's just, it seems like it would have been just terribly boring if we hadn't been here in the colonies in October. You catch what I'm saying?
we smoked a lot of weed.
We are higher than Big Ben right now. That's considerable.
Oh, it's I don't even know what your name is, but I just want to say it's 4:20 somewhere.
Right. Well, it's 10:18 or 17. I'm not exactly sure. Somewhere as well. Because that's the date in Canada you get in October.
Wait a second. He was a vampire.
Yes, sent to raid. Because he was the world, you see. Because despite all of his rage, he was still just a rat in a cage.
He wasn't a rock man.
Right? Oh, and a dreadful one at that. My God. Oh, it sounded like the Tea Party, but only worse.
You might say it was corny.
Oh, I would slip not on that one.
What's that? Oh, yes, Reginald, but... these gents are about to record a podcast talking about
The people are actually watch this? Sober, Cecil?
Clear mind and body?
Seriously, not an ounce. Oh. Or gram, I guess. My goodness, I couldn't even imagine.
I couldn't even imagine.
Cecil could not even imagine.
Let's
leave them to it. Let's go get some crumpets. I have the munchies.
Cheers!
Yes, cheers!
Welcome, everyone, to another episode of What Were They Thinking? And it is still Schlocktober.
Yes, spooky.
Chains rattling.
Ghost noises.
Oh, what's that? The Woman in Black? Okay, I only said that because I watched that movie for the first time like 8 minutes ago.
It says here in my copy, werewolf smell? How are we going to get that one across?
I don't know. Okay. I don't know.
Let's just run on past that then.
Okay.
Talk about this being a podcast and all.
This is a podcast. Called What Were They Thinking? We talk about bad to questionable movies.
Yeah.
Always questionable, usually bad. I'm Brendan.
I'm Nathan.
And we have a returning guest here on the show. She was here for one of the greatest films we've talked about on this podcast, Cats. But she is back once again, ladies and gentlemen, scowling at me over the interwebs, Amanda the Jedi. Welcome back.
What's up? Thank you so much for having me back.
Yeah. I thought you get to make up for it, right?
Oh, of course. In better spirits. When you were like, these are the list of horrible movies, and I saw this one, I was like, man, I like that movie. Let's go.
Well, we might have some contention here.
We'll see.
Let's see if it comes to blows. It's only, an hour and a half away. This podcast could turn into a tussle.
It certainly could.
But this, we are talking about, of course, the 2002 classic, Queen of the Damned.
The Carol Baskin biopic, even though it wasn't even a thing at the time.
They were ahead of their time.
Yeah,
starring Stuart, Townsend, and about 8 minutes of Aaliyah.
Oh my god! Yeah. I'll say this: if I was a fan of Aaliyah, and they had suckered me into coming to see this movie, paying theater money for this movie,
I would have been exceedingly upset.
Amanda, were you this fan?
No, I didn't know who Aaliyah was when I was in middle school. But no, I don't know. It was like one of those things. I didn't even know that Aaliyah had passed away until it gets to the end of the movie when you're watching it. And I just remember, like, I watched this when I was in this huge vampire phase, like pre-Twilight. Mm-hmm. So it's like I was really into X-Men and I was really into vampires. So like Underworld had caught my attention. So I was like, hell yeah, Underworld. And everyone was like, oh, Queen of the Damned came out too. And I was like, let's go. And then I was like a huge Linkin Park fan at the time. Big fan of different types of butt rock. So I was like, this whole soundtrack is butt rock. This is amazing. Of course, back then I wasn't like, this is hardcore. It's basically like the most 2003 experience you can have in a vampire movie. And yeah,
it is absolutely. It is very much representative of the year that it came out.
Yeah, for better or for worse.
Trust me, for worse.
Not love it. There's just something like refreshing about seeing something that's so dated to the time period, that like everything from the style to the music to the behavior to like, wow, this guy woke up after a millennia because he heard Korn. Like, that's amazing. Like, it's just so, it to me, I think this movie actually gets into an area where it's like so bad that it's very fun to watch. So,
well, they spent $35 million to make this movie.
Wow.
Like, that's nothing. That's nothing.
And it made $45.5 million worldwide.
That's shockingly low.
Yeah, that's well, I'm guessing that's why we haven't had a lot of Anne Rice adaptations since.
Well, so she disavowed, like, she was fine with it at first and signed off on it. Yeah. And then it was like 2 years later that she was like, forget this movie ever happened. It's horrible. And then went one step further for a while and completely disavowed everything about the vampire stuff she had done, because she like went uber Christian for a bit. Now she's okay with it again. So for a while, I don't think legally anybody could do anything with her properties,
so
whether they wanted to or not.
She's the vampire world equivalent of Stan Lee, then.
Obviously.
Obviously.
No, worse. Way worse.
Not the worst thing a formerly beloved female author has done in
nope,
public.
No, definitely not the worst.
But there you have it, Queen of the Damned. This movie is about a vampire, and how do we know that? Because we start out with one of my favorite tropes in films: voiceover narration.
Mm-hmm.
It basically tells us that being a vampire sucks.
You just
I think there's
even,
like, another movie that's all about that.
Actually, couldn't even get 10 minutes into the goddamn episode, could you?
I gotta get out of the way, right?
I suppose.
Oh, what you're talking about? Sorry, Amanda, were you talking about Vampires Suck? The
yeah,
film?
There's literally just an entire movie that's dedicated to telling you.
Oh, not coming soon.
Yeah, created by soon. Those who shall not be named.
I actually don't even know who made that movie. I haven't watched it. I'm sure it's trash.
The parody guys, I'm pretty sure.
Is there actually like a group of people who do that? Because I hate all of those movies.
It's
like,
there were two guys that were
two, yeah.
Yeah, they were responsible for the majority of those.
Epic movie, Eww. Date movie, all that bullshit.
Oh.
Yeah.
Horrible.
So we meet Lestat, formerly played by Tom Cruise, now played by Stuart Townsend. You know, good trade off, right?
I would say, actually. Fuck Tom Cruise.
Oh, wow. Okay. He is, he's just having a great time. He wakes up from his, like, what, 1,000-year slumber or something like that, because he hears some shitty rock music that, I'm told, was all recorded by Korn.
Was it?
Yeah, apparently. Or, like, his
that
vocals
song
were,
was.
Okay.
A bunch of songs, like, pretty much everything that he ends up singing is recorded by song, but then the soundtrack will bring in like different people. So like a couple songs have like Chester Bennington on vocals, people from like Static X do things. Like there's just a couple of, there are songs that are made by other people, but I think everything for the movie, I think Jonathan Davis does it all.
Yeah. I think he does all the lead guys' vocals is what I read.
Yeah.
See, when I heard it, I legitimately thought it sounded like the Tea Party.
The political party.
The band, the Tea Party. The terrible Canadian band, the Tea Party. I don't care. Don't at me and fight me if you want. They are dreadful.
I don't even know who they are, so I'm on your side.
Yeah.
But yeah, this shitty rock music brings him to life, and he goes over to where this band is practicing, and he's basically like, listen, guys, you're great, but I'm a vampire, so you should probably bring me into the band.
I'll make you famous. And then, just like that.
Immediately.
I will say this. If this were happening in the real world, the vampire stuff, like, being real aside, if a group was like, yeah, our lead singer's a vampire, and they kayfabed it, like, super hard, I might not like their music, but I would give them mad respect because I love a good gimmick.
Yeah, absolutely.
I do
stick to it.
I do feel though that this gimmick would not have lasting power. Like I don't think they would be at the top of the fucking. They would be at the top of the charts for like 4 months.
The Undertaker. So,
but it's hard to say. Like if they could actually manage to keep the mystique around him. That would be interesting because I feel like that's the biggest thing that's different from celebrities now from like years ago, that there's just no mystique anybody. You have full access to everybody's lives, like what color underwear they have, like literally everything you could want to know is pretty much out there. So if you could really commit to the bit, you could probably keep people interested for like a decent amount of time. But yes, this definitely also would have done better as a concept in the 2000s.
Yeah.
Seems like a good time to plug my Squarespace website, celebrityundies.org. It's a non-profit, so everything's good. Don't worry about it.
Like, you joke, but there is, like, wiki feet. So, like... Oh
my. What? Well, where's that website?
We'll take a five-minute break here.
So I know not to go to it.
Yeah. The star button means it's blocked, right?
Totally.
So yeah, they let him join the band, and we fast forward to Glastonbury, where we meet Goth Spice and Becky Spice.
the two girls that go into his mansion or whatever?
Yeah, the groupies, yeah.
Yeah. Not before we hear the line, sex, blood, and rock and roll.
Rock and roll. Yeah, at their press conference, their meeting, because they're going to, the one show, he's only going to do one show because he doesn't like repeating himself.
Yeah.
Which has to be hard when you're like a centuries old vampire. Which eventually something's got to overlap.
I also got to say, what PR guy in their right mind would take them on if that was the case?
Right.
get cash quick and get out.
It's like I get 10% of this one concert that you do.
Even some of the best comedians will do the same stuff for at least a year.
Yeah.
Like, different stuff at every show. I don't even feel like fans would be super into that. It's like, no, I want to hear the songs that I like. I don't want to see the same shit every time.
You know that tune I heard on the radio that really turned me on to your band? Yeah, play that or I don't ever want to come to your show.
It's like imagine if every concert with Steven Tyler come out and be like, all right, we're going to play some stuff off our new album. Like, people would leave.
Apparently, Oasis and Radiohead were really bad for that back in the day.
Oh, really?
White Stripes are really bad for that, too. They literally will just, like, when they were still playing towards the end, they would just, like, doodle for, like, 2 hours. It would just be, like, weird improvisation. It's like, what are you doing?
I went to see Queens of the Stone Age years ago, and they did something very similar. They played hits, but there were no, like, stage raps or anything like that. You wouldn't really tell there was a break in the songs. They would just stop and just noodle on the guitar or the drums or the bass and then go into the next song. I get so fed up with it.
Well, Lestat is, like, you're right. So he gets those two girls brought to his mansion. He's basically like Elvis when the Colonel brings them ladies after the show. except I don't believe Elvis ate them, but I could be wrong.
You could be wrong.
I could be wrong. There wasn't enough video evidence back then.
Exactly.
But Lestat is, yeah, he's given these groupies, and they have some very weird tickling foreplay.
Yeah, I have a note here. This scene is an epic hack, right?
It seemed like it was weird.
Mm-hmm.
But soon he, you know, kills them and eats them. Our hero of the film, ladies and gentlemen.
We smash cut to a chilly, chilly morning.
Oh, no.
I know it was chilly because the high beams were on.
Are we talking about Jesse?
Yes.
Jesse played by, I don't know.
Something Marino?
Yeah. Dan Marino.
Dan Marino.
But the weird thing is the movie then continues the voiceover, but now Jesse's doing the voiceover. That, and I'm like, why?
Yes, the inconsistent narration on this really drove me up a wall. It's like an Uwe Boll movie.
Marguerite Moreau. Sorry, I'm just going to...
Of course.
Marguerite Moreau. It's both their stories, okay? Like, no, I get it. I've only realized, like, recently how much, like, bad voiceovers can truly just destroy something.
Mm-hmm.
15-17 to Paris.
we get a flashback about her aunt, who she used to live with.
Yeah.
And then she's watching MTV News. Like, it's...
Yeah, she's talking about her weird, like, orphan dreams. And her mom was a vampire, just like the title of a Disney movie. Of the week.
Oh. I might be doing that a lot. I'm just gonna warn you all right now.
The world is a vampire.
I made that joke the other day, and the person in the room was just blankly stared at me. I was like, "What? You've never heard Smashing Pumpkins before?" They're like, "No." I was like,
"Wow."
I've never even heard that whole song, and I still know that line.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, sorry. I just feel like their band name promotes violence. And
she was like, well, I was born in 89. I was like, that's no excuse. The music still exists.
Yeah, seriously. That is not an excuse.
Yeah, I don't know if you know this, guys, but in June of 1988, Smashing Pumpkins were actually removed from the earth. We couldn't find it anymore. It was banned. Just like that fucking Sweetener that was banned in the 70s.
Oh, I was going to say, just like the Nightmare on My Street video.
Oh, okay. What's
that? That's a Will Smith, DJ Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince song about Nightmare on Elm Street. They made a video, and then it got quickly yanked because apparently they didn't clear all the rights that they thought they had cleared so they could use Freddy Krueger in the likeness of Freddy Krueger in the video. Mm-hmm. And they yanked it from MTV and destroyed the masters. So there's nary a copy of that video kicking around.
Oh,
wow.
It's a real Snow White at the Oscars scenario.
So...
But yeah, Jesse is, so Queen of the Damned, Jesse is presenting her research, her Lestat research, about this pub called the Admiral's Arms, and she's like, I think this is a vampire coven.
To Talamasca.
And all these, like, old people in the room are like, no, fuck off, you don't know what you're talking about. And we find out that this is, like, some sort of society that they're, like, constantly on the hunt for vampires, or at least researching
them. Yeah, supernatural. It's, like, an entire supernatural research organization called the Talamascan.
So they're, like, the British version of, like, the Hellboy's group.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Wasn't Hellboy's group British?
I think so, actually.
I thought it was just a world thing.
Oh.
Oh, yeah, it's probably a world
thing. I just pictured the dude that was, like, leading it, like, Professor...
Oh, the John Hurt?
Yeah, yeah. Just because he was British, it made me think that everything mm-hmm. was. Yeah, so, you know, they don't care. And Jesse then meets up with her mentor, David Talbot, her mentor. And, I'm just going to pull up this picture for a second, guys, because there was something weird in this room that I just... maybe it's not weird to anyone else, but I just thought this was a weird little detail. Hold on here. All right. So do you guys see that picture there? Oh, hold on.
I see the skeleton with a mohawk.
Okay, yeah, what is that? Oh, sorry.
Oh.
Yeah, what the fuck is that skeleton wearing in the room?
Well, it looks like traditional, like, Native American garb, but I'm not sure why it's got, why it's got Beekman's hair.
Yeah, I thought that was so strange. I thought it was, like, one of those, like hats that, like, the British guards wear, but turned sideways.
I think that just goes straight
falling
up.
Over a little bit.
Well, that's what I mean. Like, it looks like it fell over. It's just... But yeah, I don't know. I just thought that was a weird little detail.
There's not enough moose in his bear skin. you see, because the moose is hair product, but it's also edible.
But yeah, she's meeting with him, and he's basically like, listen, I believe you, obviously. And they believe you, but you shouldn't be out there dealing with vampires. You're just a wee little girl. You don't want to get involved. You're going to get yourself killed, et cetera, et cetera. And then he's like, hey, you know what would really be helpful in derailing this movie? Let's do a 25-minute flashback.
Oh, my God. Just look at some Marius paintings and then a flashback. Like, ah, come on.
The flashback does go on for a very long time. Amanda, is this killing you inside, just us ripping this movie apart a little bit?
No, you're good. Okay. You're good. It's like I said, I literally hadn't watched it since sometime in high school.
Okay.
So it's like, I am aware that there are faults in this movie, but there, like I said, there's just something so charmingly 2000, early 2000 about it that I'm like, you know what? This is history, and it's important.
Dude, I'm not gonna lie. It's kind of like Ninja Turtles 3. When I saw Ninja Turtles 3, I enjoyed it immensely because I was part of the target audience. Watching it back now, I know full well it is not a good movie at all, as our episode with Dame Malcolm Wallace showed us.
Yeah, that happened with me with Masters of the Universe. Yeah, I get it.
See?
I get it. but yeah, this flashback shows Marius is the one that turned Lestat into a vampire. Mm-hmm. Oh, and then he feeds him blood from his arm. It's a very romantic scene.
Yeah,
it is. He was definitely looking for something more than a companion.
Yeah. I mean, we don't say that because it was 2002, but, you know, come on. And apparently, so there's this rule there that gets introduced in this movie that apparently if you drink someone's blood, like all of someone's blood, it will kill you.
Right to the last drop. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which is like, oh, okay, we're just gonna slowly introduce that into the vampire lore. All right.
You know, I gotta say it's a dumb rule. I'll say this, but at least it goes along with something that a vampire would do and something that they should be cautious about.
Mm-hmm.
Not that they, you know, glitter in the sun.
What movie is that?
Yeah. Vampires Look, suck, actually. I think they introduced it in that.
Okay.
Obviously. Okay. Just in the slight defense of that, nobody says shit about the garlic stuff. Everyone's like, oh yeah, vampires allergic to garlic. That's totally fine. But the second it's like, oh yeah, their skin is so rock hard that like the sun reflects it in a way that it looks like their skin's on fire, which is what she's trying to retcon it to now. It was definitely sparkling like a bunch of diamonds originally, but I'm not saying it's not dumb. I'm just saying that like so much lore is dumb and no one gets caught up on any of it until it's like... Yeah, they can go out in the day, but this is going
to
happen.
I get that. The garlic thing never ever really made a whole lot of sense to me either.
Yeah, it's dumb as shit. So. And like not being able to see the reflection in mirrors. Everyone's like, oh yeah, I'm fine. Anyways, the last drop thing, that at least seems kind of like something that would make sense and be kind of ominous.
I think the mirror thing had to do more with the fact that they're soulless. And the supernatural idea that you couldn't cast a reflection if you didn't have a soul.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
So, but the garlic's still weird.
Garlic is dumb.
Well, guys, I mean, Lestat is getting, you know, Marius is giving him the talk, as you do with every young young man growing up into the world. And they find some hippies in the 16th century and just start
they murder a drum circle. Great.
They do. Lestat just wants to jam out with them and then I guess can't control his eyes glowing up like a fucking monster, so Marius is like, we have to kill them, and he, you know, breaks the dude's neck, and Lestat
kills the girl.
He breaks her neck too. A lot of neck breaking in this movie. and that's how he begins his attraction to music.
One does.
Yeah. I remember my first drum circle I killed. God,
couldn't shake the couldn't shake the rhythm after that, could you?
Oh man, it was part of me after that moment. After that, Marius is out painting on the beach, as you do when you're a vampire.
Of course.
And Lestat finds a hidden entrance to these like statues. And at this point of the movie, I'm like, where is any of this going?
I also like that apparently that Marius had the vamper installed in the castle. You know, vamp on, vamp off, vamp on, vamp off. Because anytime he walked near one of the torches, they lit up. Just sensing that there was a vampire there.
Okay, boys. Lestat's in the room. Get to work. But he finds the statue and he's like mesmerized by it, and he starts playing
his
violin for it.
Yes.
Which is a scene that isolated from this movie looks hilarious. Like, this is a scene that I would be like, just watch this scene for a second. and then he bites the arm of the statue and apparently there's blood in it.
I really wanted to like chip a tooth on that statue. Like just a broken fang because he bit the statue before it was ripe.
He at least waits to see if, like, the blood is pumping through the visible veins.
Yeah.
And he can, like, see into this... I won't say who it is yet, but he can see into this statue's, like, former life.
Oh,
or
yeah,
something.
He gets,
like,
the vampo vision.
Yeah.
Marius is very upset that he's done this, and Lestat nearly... Well, Lestat pretty much passes out, and Marius ties him down and is like, that's it. I'm leaving. I'm gone forever. Goodbye. The statues are gone. Yeah, yeah. I resign today as president of the bank. when he leaves, I'll never get that movie out of my head. Lestat is squirming around, and... after that flashback, we are almost halfway through this movie. I'm not even joking. We're like a good 35, 40 minutes into this movie.
I don't know what movie you're watching because it was not a good 35 minutes for me. I was so dreadfully bored. I'm not going to lie with this movie. Like, that's its biggest sin for me.
I think I'm somewhere in between you guys. Somewhere in between.
Yeah.
Like I said, I'm fully willing to admit that, like, my taste here is being affected by the fact that, like, I was 13 and this is so cool to a 13-year-old.
Yes, I could understand how that would be.
Like a 12-year-old. You know? You're like, oh, yeah, this is the best.
I had a few friends who were Anne Rice geeks back in the day, and they couldn't get enough of anything, like the books. They saw the, you know, Interview with the Vampire like a gajillion times. I'm pretty sure they went to see this. I don't know, because I was in university at the time and they were all back here, but yeah, not good.
Well, now Jesse, I think, might get the Too Dumb to Live award because she decides to go to the Admiral's Arms all by herself.
Right. And
the pub which she told everyone is a fucking vampire coven, and she's like, I'm just gonna go investigate.
I'm gonna walk in like a goth and it's gonna be fine.
And they told her not to go there, like, directly. Yep. Did you notice that they had I know I've already said made the song reference like three or four times now, but did you notice there was a Billy Corgan vampire in this mix?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Like
yeah.
Yeah,
the bald dude.
So yeah, she goes into the bar and she's all like, what is she doing? She's asking about, like, if anyone knows where Lestat is or something, or, and then she says, like, when they ask her, like, who's your guy? And she's like, Marius.
Yeah.
And they're like, they're all calling bullshit on her because
they're like, that's an ancient. They don't exist anymore.
Yeah. She's like the worst liar ever.
Well, she
does a decent job.
I mean, okay, well.
In this movie.
Talking, in this movie, yeah. Okay, fine. When we're talking real life, I can think of some worse examples. Or better examples. So she's obviously, she's being dumb. She's in that bar. A bunch of vampires, like, meet her outside, and they're clearly going to fuck her up. But Lestat comes in for the rescue, and we're like, why would he rescue her? But I guess he was just intrigued because he heard her say Marius.
Yes, well, because he, I guess, Marius left after the whole incident with the statues, and he never saw him again.
That sounds so stupid.
It does sound, you know why? Because it's fucking dumb. So he spent...
I think it was jealousy, wasn't
something
it?
Like, yes, because he...
It's because he's jealous because he had been holding on to these two, like, first vampires for his entire life and, like, hoping that he could get some attention, and, like, nobody presented... Now, they didn't move for centuries until Lestat pulls out the fiddle, and then suddenly, you know, she's allowing him to feed off of her, which makes him, like, insane, basically, for a little bit, with power and bloodlust. So he's like, I'm bouncing out with these.
Yeah.
Now, are you sure he's jealous of the statues or Lestat?
Well, he... No,
I think in that moment it was the statue, but also, like, the fact that Lestat was like, I don't need you anymore because I have that, but...
I think it's that he was jealous of the fact that the statues responded to Lestat and not him.
Yeah, and not him.
Yeah. I mean, I just think there's a relationship going on here somewhere.
So, and because of that, after Marius left, he says, I think he said in one of the endless narrations that he spent, you know, years and years looking for Marius but never finding him, calling out his name and never hearing from him. So when she mentions, you know, Marius by name, that obviously that perks up Lestat's ears.
Yeah, and
his glowing eyes in the dark.
Right.
And we get some real sexual tension between these two here, because she is seeing him for the first time, and she wants the, she's ready, she's in, she's 100%. And he like makes it so that he doesn't bite her, because she says at one point, like, I think she like dares him to basically like taunts him, right? And he doesn't bite her or anything, but he like pushes her hand into like a piece of broken glass and then just like licks the blood up. And he's like, so, I mean, he's not an asshole, but he's also super unsanitary.
He also did. It's just straight murder those groupies. So, I mean, I think the jury's still out on him being just an asshole.
That's true.
Who's worse, though? Him asking for the groupies or the assistant just being like, yep, I'm going to bring these bodies up. Like, which one is worse?
Lambs to the slaughter, she is.
Yeah, exactly.
So your question is in the film, Let the Right One In, who's worse, Ellie or or her handler?
Yeah. Oof.
That's a question that will plague us for all time.
It's true.
So, yeah, Lestat is like, you know, basically tells her to fuck off, essentially, and calls her a clever librarian. That's like the biggest insult.
Little book reader.
Gaining knowledge from literature.
Nerd.
That would be great. Yeah. He just straight up was like, fucking nerd. So Lestat goes home and violently plays his violin, because I guess that's how he gets his rage out. And David is not happy with Jesse. He's like, why did you go there? Why did you go to that bar? And now you're going to go to the concert where Lestat is telling other vampires like to come and present themselves? Because we didn't really mention this, but all the other vampires are pissed off at Lestat because he is like very open about the fact that he's a vampire when they're supposed to obviously remain in the shadows.
Right.
And he's basically called out any vampire to come to this concert and if they got a problem, basically, to deal with it.
Yeah. Yep, that's pretty much one. Thumbs it up.
And again, so, not a safe place for Jesse to go.
So, of course, she catches a plane to L.A. so she can head to Death Valley.
Yeah. I don't know why, too, but like, there's a scene, too, where Lestat is in his coffin and he's like wearing headphones, and that just made me laugh a lot.
Yeah.
And
they're like the giant, like, over-the-ear headphones.
Yeah.
That's all they had to work with back then.
Oh, come on. The AirPods were around. It was 2000.
No, they weren't.
I had earbuds, and they weren't AirPods, but they had earbuds. So, I mean, he could have definitely used those.
His hearing's too sensitive for that. It's going to cause damage.
I like how you're inventing character traits.
Yeah.
I am. Yeah. Look, super hearing.
At one point, someone says Lestat is bigger than Elvis.
To which everybody who was over the age of 13 was like, no.
Vampire gimmick or not. No, come on, man. But Marius, guys, Marius is back in the movie, and he found Lestat quite easily. He said, all I had to do was find, like, basically a gauche house, and I knew it was you. which is insane, because, like, so you're telling me that, like, all no the press, other celebrity.
No, not even that. Yeah. All the press that he did, basically announcing where he was going to be. I don't feel that Marius had to look for a gauche house. He just had to head on to Death Valley, and find him there.
I mean, true. I do think his explanation is weird, though, how he just looked for the shittiest.
I'm assuming, I just looked for the most gaudy house I could find. They could have gone with, like, I'm the one who made you, so I can find you anywhere you are in the world.
Yeah.
Well, I think, I mean, he's a vampire, so I think it's just kind of supposed to be a catty dig as well.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, exactly.
He's like, I know your
smell. I think
smell.
It is. It's just a joke. I know you have shit taste in houses, so I found you.
I could smell you from Romania, okay?
Just sassy Marius.
Well, I love also, you know what? I would have loved it if they had leaned into that, because that is actually one thing that, by and large, I have found that most vampires portrayed in movies are catty.
Or batty.
Well, that too, but...
So Lestat and Marius are having a conversation in a painter's bench right in front of a billboard where Lestat's crotch is.
Yes, these are things that happen in the movie, folks.
Yep. And then we hear Marius tells us Akasha is awoken. We're like, oh, who is that? Who is Akasha?
Well, that was the statue from earlier. He even said her name in the flashback.
You know what?
You know what, Ethan? It's more rhetorical.
Mm.
It's more.
We're building a narrative here.
When he does mention that, we do see that she murdered a statue when she woke.
Oh yeah, because they said like she basically there was a king and a queen, and she got out of there and murdered the king statue.
Because they just show like this statue with like three big claw marks across the face.
Yep, that's all it took.
Yeah.
Oh, and man, she enters the movie, and I gotta say, even though she's only in the movie for a very short period of time, I think every scene with her in it is made better by her in it. I love Aaliyah in this movie.
I did.
She's like pretty solid, actually.
I found it unintentionally ironic that the song that was playing when she showed up at the bar was "Why Won't You Die."
Oh,
ooh, they had time to fix that.
They did, and they didn't. So,
what luckily, a tragic life she had.
Luckily, they did not pull a Street Fighter after the credits.
Yeah,
I do have that written down. That there was no shot of Aaliyah like blinking or something. Thank goodness. But yeah, this is actually my favorite scene in the movie, where she comes into the Admiral's Arms bar and finds out that she's looking for Lestat, and she finds out that all these vampires are like, yeah, we're going to go to his concert and fucking murder him because he's telling everybody where the vampires are. And she's like, oh, really?
Spot on Aaliyah impression there, by the way.
Thank you. but she wastes everyone. Like, yeah. Everyone basically gets set on fire. It's like a Nick Cage vampire movie.
Yeah.
She's like cutting throats and throwing people across the room. By the way, Aaliyah is like 5 feet tall, so it's hilarious to watch this.
Yes.
Just this demure, like small actress singer just like decimating like 30 people.
It's great. I love it.
Yeah. Wow.
It's like when you watch Hit Girl do her thing in Kick-Ass.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, same idea. Same quality movie. I get it. but yeah, she wastes everyone, and then Jesse makes another genius move. Is that she gets to Death Valley, and after she has a run-in with a cameo by the dude in Korn as a ticket scalper. I looked that up after because I don't know what he looks
amazing.
Like.
Amazing.
But she finds her way onto Lestat's two-girl menu to go to his castle.
Because I have a note here. It's pasty spice and hot topic spice.
Oh, man. And then she goes there and, you know, Lestat obviously tells the other girl to fuck off. And hold on.
The Episcopalian.
Yeah. What is he saying?
I'm an Episcopalian. Because she's like, the Talamascans here. And then she's like, I'm an Episcopalian. Come on. That's just a 10 out of 10. That's hilarious. Probably Well, no, that was definitely
no, that was an intended good for them. Bit of humor.
Well, this movie,
yeah, that was intended.
This movie has jokes.
It was a good joke. I liked it.
So the other girl is told to leave. Jesse is still there. And then we kind of have like this movie's version of like that scene in the first Superman movie where like Lois is flying with Superman for the first time. So he's like taking her around the city.
Oh,
basically.
Yeah. So my note is, oh, the park scene. This is garbage.
Garbage. How eloquent. Like, what a way with words.
I'm sorry, but sometimes it's the only thing that fits. He possesses another vampire to leave this one woman on the bench alone.
So he can kill her.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because he's
like, is this the life you want?
Yeah. I wrote down it's like a more aggro version of Twilight.
It is, yeah. It's all like, as if you could run from me. You know, it's just like that.
Because she really wants to be a vampire. And he's basically like, is this what you want? Like,
it's not as romantic as you think.
Yeah, exactly. I don't sparkle. and after he kills that woman, obviously Jesse has a much different look on her face. But I think she's still in. I think she still wants to
it. Yeah, she definitely. Yeah, she's been lifelong goals.
What's a murder? And then I guess at this point we cut to the concert with probably the worst parking setup I've ever seen. Like, no one's getting out of there.
So the oddest things we notice in these things, don't we?
I have to, like, I mean, when the main stuff on screen is driving me insane, I have to find other things going on to latch onto. But, like, I'm just saying, like, that's going to take a long time. There's going to be a lot of beeping and swearing and you know, dents and fender benders and whatnot.
I have to get to Kinko's for work in the morning. You know how long it takes me to get this goth makeup off? I can't go to
the office looking like Alice Cooper.
I can't show up at the frozen yogurt stand at the food court for work tomorrow looking like this.
They'll understand. He's bigger than Elvis. So this concert, of course, is terrible. The music is terrible.
Because it's ass rock.
It is the ass rock that we all knew and loved back in the day.
And it's still exceedingly popular. We're just the ones who've moved on.
Is it really still?
It is, actually.
Jesus.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Butt rock's still a thing.
Butt rock is, like, it just dominates in certain areas, just, like, not areas that we are.
I noted, though, like, so the funniest thing is that the criticism is that all the vampires are mad that he's, like, open about being a vampire and they want to remain hidden. But, I mean, if you look into that crowd, you could easily tell every single vampire in that crowd.
Wow, look at this person in the cloak. Wow.
Well, if you couldn't, the fight begins, and then you can tell for sure. Yeah,
well, I obviously. Do want to
well, no,
know...
No, they think it's all a gimmick.
Yeah, well, I do want to know before the fight, though, is that one of those vampires had a really nice White House coat.
It was Mordecai.
Oh, shit. Wrestling reference got it in. Boom. Signed, sealed, delivered. That's what I did have a question about that. So you said, obviously, the people watching this think this fight is, like, part of the show. But I was like, do they? Because you see someone get stabbed through the chest.
Yeah, like that. Yeah, but it's like.
Dude, you should check out some of the stuff Rammstein has done over the years.
Yeah, like, people do all sorts of crazy stuff on stage. And, like, you would expect if this is going to be this guy's only show ever and he's putting on this facade of being a vampire, if you believe it's real, even if you don't believe it's real, like, you think it's a show. Like, you don't think people are actually being, like, burned alive in front of you. You think it's stage effects.
Absolute theatrics. Look at Kiss, Marilyn Manson.
Gwar.
Yeah, Gwar is a great example.
Gwar gets hella into it, yeah. Oh, yeah. They definitely thought that was a bit.
Listen, guys, I'll just never be the same since Spinal Tap brought the real devil on stage. that got me bad.
There you go.
We salute you, our half-inflated Dark Lord.
And then they played Big Bottom, and I was good. So, yeah, big fight. Lots of vampires getting killed. Marius shows up and helps Lestat beat up a bunch of them as well. With some terrible, like, motion blur special effects.
Oh, they were going all Matrix-y.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's just like, oh, if you can't shoot it, don't shoot it. And then, never mind that shit, here comes Akasha.
Yes.
Just like Mongo, she shows up on the stage and, you know, she just looks very uncomfortable on a concert stage. It's weird. I don't know why they would put her there. And she quickly grabs Lestat, and they just fucking rocket off into space. She's basically like Poochie, like my
whole
planet
needs me. That's exactly what I wrote. So she's Poochie. My planet needs me.
Akasha died on the way back to her home planet.
Oh, my God. I had to pause it at this point, I think, and my next note is, thank God, less than 30 left.
We're rounding the bend. Mm. She tells Lestat, you are very bold, much like your music. You haven't heard a lot of music.
Yeah. Apparently the Queen of the Dam lives in Modesto.
Oh, cue the weird music, tub full of rose petals, heavy makeout, biting, and sex. That's right, folks. It's a 2002 sex scene.
Yeah.
With Stuart Townsend and Aaliyah.
And Aaliyah.
Question, though. Mm. Who's crazier, Akasha or whoever had that crazy doll collection?
The doll collection.
Okay.
Akash is just like a, you know, she's just a representation of the time period she's from. Whoever owned those dolls is just wrong forever.
She's the definition of, like, it was a different time.
Exactly.
It's fine, guys.
It's fine, guys.
Vampires just, you know, just wiped out humanity back then. It was accepted then.
It was a different time.
So Jesse then ends up back. I don't know how this happens, but I guess she passes out at the concert or something. Or Marius, maybe he brings her to, like, where her aunt.
She goes to visit her aunt. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And yeah. They don't. This is probably just. There's just too much going on for this to be a movie.
Especially at this point, because the thing with Akasha and Lestat is it happens like an hour and change into this movie.
Yeah.
And it's like, this is okay.
This is called The Queen of the Damned, and that is The Queen of the Damned.
Yeah.
I guess it delivers what it promises, technically.
That's true. Yes,
you don't introduce Batman 75% of the way through The Dark Knight. But yeah, Jesse's at her aunt's place, and you know, her aunt hasn't aged a day, and that's because she's a vampire.
Centurate.
And I guess Jesse. So what's the deal? Like, Jesse was, like, her father was killed or something, and I didn't get this part at all.
Her mom died in a car accident when she was pregnant with Jesse, from my memory. Mm-hmm. And then I'm pretty sure, like, the aunt just shows up and gives her a name. Like, I can't remember fully because it's been, like, a really long time, but I just remember that, like, the mom died in a car crash when she was pregnant.
Okay.
That's my recollection. And then, yeah, I can't remember the details around that.
Yeah, it's weird. She just kind of is there. And then she gives her, and then she gave like Jesse away to like that society or something. I think. I don't know. It's a movie.
No, I think she just works for that.
So what you're saying is there's some plot holes in the movie. And
well, yeah. I mean,
she didn't get given away to the society. She just started working for that society.
Okay.
Yeah.
Not only does she get to see her aunt again, but apparently there's a whole Vampire Justice League there, including Vampire Phil Spector and Vampire Lars Ulrich.
Both better than the human versions.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
They murdered thousands. Still better people.
Still better people.
Nothing really of note happens here. She just finds out, like, oh, yeah, you were a vampire the whole time. Ah, maybe that's why I like vampires so much.
Whoa.
What other place can I go to where I'll probably get murdered because I'm dumb? But after Lestat and we go back to Lestat and Akasha, and Lestat is getting up all, you know, post-fuck. And he notices that Akasha has, like, murdered, like, 100 people.
They're just lying dead on the beach.
Oh, yeah, this is our kingdom, the kingdom of corpses.
Yeah.
Yeah, and he's all, is this really what you want? And she's like, yeah, huh?
Totally. Don't you?
Sounds good to me. And they decide to go to the aunt's place. I don't even know why they go there. I guess Akasha just wants to, like, kill more vampires.
To
I don't know.
Kill her. Which is exactly how she delivered in the movie.
No, I think she's going there to, like, build her, like, coven, basically. Okay. And then they're just kind of like, I will not submit.
Right.
You know? Yeah.
And that's when they say, kill her.
We shall overcome. Right?
Yeah, totally.
So they go to this place. The aunt is there. Basically, Lestat essentially has a dog collar. He's got a lot of. It looks like he has a bunch of like things on his belt. It looks like he's wearing like Tommy Wiseau's pants from The Room. maybe that's where he got the idea. I would love if Tommy Wiseau was just randomly a big fan of Queen of the Damned and Rebel Without a Cause. But they confront a bunch of vampires, and Akasha basically tells Lestat to kill Jesse. So, I mean, he bites her because, yeah, the camera just starts getting slow and spinny, and he starts biting her. And I guess the idea is that she wanted him to do that anyway, so it's not totally him killing her. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
My note here is that these effects are dreadful.
Oh, the special effects were so bad.
Well, like, they only had $35 million.
Right.
Only. Lestat then starts sucking Akasha's blood because, you know, she's like, here's your prize. And he starts sucking too much blood. And she's like,
and
no,
looks
no.
up and it's like, oh, he is trying to kill her.
Yeah. And then other vampires start, like, fucking bum rushing her and drinking all her blood up. And her powers are fading, guys. Her powers are fading. The walls are going to come crumbling down. But the aunt steps up and is like, whoa, slow down, big boy. I'm going to be the one to drink all that blood.
Yeah.
And she turns into a statue.
She's
what
sleeping.
Happens in the movie.
Yep.
She sucks all of the vampire's blood and, yeah, she's sleeping, as they say, and becomes a statue. And then Akasha just, like, turns to stone and then dust and then just kind of blows away.
Yeah, I actually noted here that the effects budget was probably spent mostly on her, like, fadeaway.
Yeah. Yeah. Lestat lets Jesse recover. He lets her feed on him because he's recently turned her, obviously, by biting her. And then this scene at the end that doesn't really... I don't really understand this whole ending scene. I mean, I understand it, but I don't get why, like, it goes the way it goes. So they visit, like, David, who's, like, Jesse's mentor, the guy she was talking to earlier in the movie. But, like...
So they can give him back his journal.
His journal. Yeah. And he's like, oh, I think you probably want this back. And then... But then, like, Marius shows up after they leave. Yeah. And he's all...
Hello,
I'm gonna...
David.
Yeah.
Yes. And I will... I don't recall Marius being invited in.
No, that's a vampire thing they did not follow.
Right?
Yeah, they don't follow that one. Also, but that's not a residence, though. That's his office. So you can get around it that way.
Maybe.
Either way, they don't prescribe to that.
No. Or like Anne Rice, the Jedi.
I'm not even. Which is, I'm just like really into vampires, guys. Like it's fine.
Wow, what a great audience.
And this. That's it.
Yeah, they give the diary back. Marius shows up, and I just don't understand. Like, why did David deserve to die? Like, what was wrong
with
him?
That's up in the air. It's ambiguous. Yes. I feel like in the movie, it's implying that Marius is like, I don't give a shit if you don't want to be a vampire. I'm gonna make you one because I need a new,
protege,
companion, companion. But in the books, that doesn't neither thing happens in the book.
Maybe he was, maybe now Marius is super fine with everybody knowing about vampires and he just shows up to give David the complete rundown on vampires.
Yeah.
Totally.
He's like, you want to grab a drink or something? Or, oh,
like, I'm just feeling like you're really obsessed with me with all these pictures you have. So, like, are we going to deal with this?
I don't want to start up this relationship on such a weird foot.
Yeah, like, I'd like to just discuss things first.
Oh, boy. So, yeah, that was Queen of the Damned. We got through that pretty quick because I'm going to
So little happens.
So little happens. Right? You're right. In an hour and 41 minutes.
I think it just hits a point where there's like, there's too much information that we need to put into this that we need to cut so much of it out just to make it like a digestible movie. Mm-hmm. And it, yeah, because if like they had wanted to do it well, it probably should have been like a mini series or something.
Yeah.
But,
have some characters and stuff.
Yeah.
But Amanda, we'll start with you. We'll start with you. Queen of the Damned, would you recommend this to your, I don't know where I'm going with this. Would you recommend this movie?
I recommend it to the vampire fans. And that's
really?
I think it's essential. I would also recommend Twilight to the vampire fans. Like, you just have to get it all in there. Like, you've got to, like, the only vampire movie I would not recommend is Vampire Suck. I'm pretty sure. I think that's the only one. And it's not that I like every vampire movie. I'm just like, yeah, might as well. This, like I said, this is just so 2003 that it's just like, and it came out in 2002, but I don't know why. 2003 is just my go-to year for back then, but it's so early 2000s. Like, everything about it just defines that time. So if you were like sentiently alive at that time. I think you can probably have a good time with this to that extent.
Sentient being.
But it gets more boring. Like, I'm weird. Like, the further it gets in the movie, I feel like it gets, like, way worse. Like, when it's early on and it's like, vampire rock star, what a dream.
Oh my God.
My middle school self thinks. But and then it gets to all the other stuff and I'm like, okay, now it's getting dumber. But yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. The romance stuff I don't really think is very good. Done very well in this movie at all.
Oh yeah, it's not established in any way, shape, or form.
Yeah. Well, Nathan, what do you think? You joining the train? You saying this is the one of the best movies we've ever done?
Oof, no.
Five out of five.
No.
It's not the worst you've ever done.
It's not.
This is true. It is it's still not considerably even, better than Postal.
It's not even close to Postal.
Right.
Let's just say that.
Yeah.
So that's a no. I did notice that they did dedicate the movie to Aaliyah.
Yep.
Though I feel if they really wanted to honor her memory, they just would not have released the movie.
Oh my God.
I do think that I do think she's fun in this movie. Her performance.
She did a good job.
We're going to get ads for that.
She was very well handled for like the 8 minutes of total screen time she has. She like really, I found she was a very believable, like, original being.
Mm. Yeah. I don't know, I just like, and like, even like with her stature, I don't know, I found like she cast a pretty intimidating shadow.
Oh yeah.
It's funny. If you want to get at Nathan for that comment that he made earlier, it's at NES Spaveld on Twitter.
Ah, good, he got it wrong. Anyhow.
Oh shit. I'll find out.
All things considered, the story that Marius tells about Akesha would have made for a far more entertaining movie where she just kind of, you know, rose to power as this, you know, vampire queen and ruled with an iron fist, and her husband lost his taste for it. And so, you know, they decided that, you know, that they would give it all up and go to sleep.
And correction, that's Super NES Spaveld on Twitter if you want to get at him for the any comments from this episode. No reason why I'm doing that on this episode, just throwing it out there. Yeah, so I feel like I'm somewhere in the middle. I feel like there's parts of this, like I still think the premise is hilarious. I think the idea of a vampire being like, I want to be in a rock band, just makes me laugh. There are parts of this that are pretty slow and dumb. Mm-hmm. But yeah, no, hangover movie.
Hangover movie.
As in you'd rather watch one of the Hangover movies than watch this one?
Maybe the first one, I guess. But yeah, so that's it. We're going to take a brief break and we will be right back.
What were they thinking?
What Were They Thinking is brought to you by HostGator. HostGator is a leading provider of shared, reseller, VPS, and dedicated hosting solutions. Award-winning support is available 24/7, 365 days a year via phone, email, and live chat. Discover why over 9 million websites trust HostGator. Use the coupon code SCHLUCK for 25% off your first purchase. That's SCHLUCK, SCHLOCK, for 25% off your first purchase.
Oh man, I've been stuck on this dungeon for like 2 weeks now. I wish I knew how to get past this stuff.
Well, there, little youngster. I think I can help you out.
Whoa, Jimmy Stewart.
Well, that's right.
Just Mr. Stewart, I've been stuck on this dungeon for 2 weeks now. Do you know where I could get some help with it?
Well, listen, if Jimmy Stewart knows one thing, it's video gaming.
You were Nintendo World Champ 3 years straight.
That's right. You know how I did that?
How?
Well, for the good folks at GameItAll.com.
Wow, they sound keen, Mr. Stewart.
It's your one-stop shop for all nerdy talk.
Do they know about up, up, down, down, left, right, B, A, B, A, start?
I think I just had a stroke.
That's GameItAll.com, giving Jimmy Stewart a stroke since 2020.
What were they thinking?
And we're back.
Yes, we are back.
Oh, it's time for NPR. Mm-hmm. Nathan, it's time for the low haiku.
Yes, it's a fixture here. I don't know what they're thinking in NPR. The low haiku, 17 perfect syllables, to describe the movie we've just spent about an hour or so talking about.
So Amanda, as our guest, I understand you worked diligently on this through the night.
I did, yes.
Would you like to read your low haiku?
Yes. Vampires own my heart. This is a shitty haiku. Anne Rice hates it too.
Well played, well played, well played.
Very good, very good.
All right, I will read my haiku here.
Okay.
Hold on. Do you mind? I actually have a guest speaker that would like to read this haiku for me.
By all means.
Okay, just one second. Rockstar vampire. Aaliyah on screen, not long. Anne Rice, sorry, babe.
Yes, it's interesting when we get Republicans on National Public Radio. Usually they're trying to just shut us down, but, I mean, thanks, Mr. Miller.
Make sure you don't vote this year.
I've already sent mine in the mail.
Ah, ah. Cha-cha-cha.
Okay, thank
you. Get out of here. God damn it.
Okay, whoa, getting spicy for NPR.
Oh, sorry, gosh.
Consarnate, I think, is as strong as we're going to allow on that one.
The censors are sweating in the booth right now.
They've got their hand over that 15-second censor button.
Yeah. Okay, well, Nathan, you have your haiku?
Yes. This thing really sucked. All show, very little go. 8 lousy minutes?
Poor Aaliyah, the worst thing that happened to her. No!
Oh my god.
Nathan, now why did you say that? Again, that's super NES spammer on Twitter. Okay, fine. Amanda, why did you say that?
You don't put this on me.
That was our poetry moment. And now, Nathan, what do we always say?
Well, you know what? We always say...
Don't take a word for it!
That's right. Oh, boy. We have got a disparity here. One of the biggest ones in a while. So, 17% of critics... liked this movie. How much of the audience liked this movie, Nathan?
Was it like 66%?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep.
66. So thank you, 13-year-old Amanda.
You know, they're welcome. They're fucking welcome.
Oh man. All right, well let's get going here with these critics reviews. We'll start out here. So Peter Travers of the Rolling Stone says the film is vampire roadkill.
Okay.
Oh my god.
Peter Travers is taking it down.
Well, Steve Newton from the Georgia Strait, lovely West Coast publication here in Canada, writes, it's mainly an excuse for director Michael Rymer to unleash his arsenal of flashy MTV-type visuals and Moulin Rouge costume designer Angus Strathy to play dress-up. 1.5 out of 5.
Burned.
All right, I've got one from Jane Dark of The Village Voice. Aaliyah fans, as well as fans of charisma, sex, and violence, will be sorely disappointed.
I'm a big violence and sex fan.
Yeah, this is just so disappointing.
Okay. Overall, this horror... this is from Emmanuel Levy of emmanuellevy.com. Overall, this horror picture, based on Rice's novel, is no good, but lead Stuart Townsend gives a far more compelling and properly campy performance than Tom Cruise did as Lestat in the high-profile companion piece Interview with the Vampire. I not on board with you.
let's see what I've got here. Urban Cinephile Critics wrote a positive review. Real brief. Well, on Rotten Tomatoes is brief anyways. Its look with haunt you.
Its look with haunt
its
you?
Its look with haunt you. Mm. That's a critic review.
Amazing.
Yeah. Wow. He's not taking it through the spell check there.
Nope. Well, the spill chuck, I guess. Because with is a word and it wouldn't have got it.
That's true.
That's true. Yeah. To flip things up and give a positive review.
That was a positive review, actually.
Oh, shit. Yeah. All right. Well, I got another one from David Hunter of The Hollywood Reporter. Directed with goth pizzazz and brains by Michael Rymer. Who paid you?
Actually, give goth pizzazz.
Because I wouldn't even go goth pizzazz and brains. That's one thing I've always said about Queen of the Damned. It is smart. And I'm saying that as someone who enjoyed it.
One thing you cannot deny is the cleverness of the script.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, this is a review from Greg Mackey of the Star Democrat in Easton, Maryland. I just want you to know.
Okay.
He gives it a 1 out of 4. This film should have stayed in its coffin and never seen the light of day. Coming up next on Gene Shalit's review show.
I wish I'd had some halls to stop the coffin.
Oh, shit.
Desson Thompson from the Washington Post, a real brief one. Devoid of even MTV caliber originality. Oof. 1 out of 5.
Yeah. Oof. Joe's apartment, you win this round.
All right. Finish got one strong. Last one.
Yeah.
From this one. Robert K. Elder from the Chicago Tribune. Queen of the Damned leaves us puzzled as to why the term damned applies at all when vampirism is depicted as so cool, fashion savvy, and glamorous. You know? And it's true.
Makes a point.
Vampire, they make vampires sexy.
Yeah, these aren't like From Dusk Till Dawn vampires.
Yeah, no, they're not.
Yeah. By the way, that's a great movie.
That is a pretty great flick.
Add it to your vampire list. Never-ending vampire list. All right, let's get into the audience reviews, because that's where the real heavy hitters are at. I got one here from Emerald B, and he or she gives it 5 stars. Emerald says, I remember making Mom play this movie over and over when I was little. Now I'm 17, and I still love it. How Rotten Tomatoes could only give it a 17% rating? I might have to scream some sense into them. Don't expect it to be exactly like the book. It isn't. Most movies aren't, in my experience. Lots of experience. Anyways, great music, great storyline, cool acting. I just love this movie. It will always be one of my favorites.
Okay. Well, I got one here from Joseph R., he writes, I'm more offended as a Korn fan than as a movie goer. They have Jonathan Davis write, W-R-I-G-H-T, the soundtrack, which is 2 words, sing the soundtrack again, 2 words, then in the movie that no talent actor lip sing to Jonathan Davis, while the actual Jonathan Davis is relegated to a bit role where he is a ticket scalper. On top of that, the movie was god-awful, acting subpar. Only good part was music. I only gave it 0.5 star because Rotten Tomatoes won't let me go lower.
Damn.
Wow, Joey Ramone did not like this movie.
He did not like it. But to flip it up, I've got a 5-star review from Elmo H. Really? 16% Rotten Tomatoes? BS. Yet, and as I state this over and over, Cabin in the Woods is a smash? Kick rocks Rotten Tomatoes with that inconsistent human excrement.
Kick rocks.
Kick rocks. Man, I ain't heard that one in a while.
And that was a review from 2017, so it's not even like this was that old.
All right. This one is from Raven N. 5 stars. I love this movie, douche. I can watch it over again. Man, I love you, When of the Damned.
When of the Damned.
I just want every review, every critic to like say what they thought and be like douche at the end of it.
Let's see what I got here. Oh, okay. Jonathan G wrote, following interview with a vampire with this monstrosity is a shame. Poor acting all around. Poor visual effects, poor plot, etc., etc. It's hard to believe there was a worse movie than The Twilight Saga. This is it. Sad that Aaliyah died with this as her final artist work. Rating 3.5 out of 10. 2 stars.
I can agree that it is in fact worse than Twilight.
That rating, I would criticize that math though.
Well, he wrote in the rating stars, but then gave it 2 stars.
Oh God.
Jesus.
I've got a simple one from Rugalato B. 2 words. Very sexy. 5 stars.
Well, hot take. All right.
Hot take.
I've got one more, and it's also a pretty quick review here. This is from Malachi, so I'm assuming it's the character from Children of the Corn. he says, will someone gift me this? I'll gift you a movie back. 5 stars.
Hell of a review. I've got one from Yuri B. He gave it 4 stars and writes, he thought this movie was great. Just said that this was Aaliyah's performance on screen. R.I.P. not that this was her last performance, but this was Aaliyah's performance on screen.
It was just sad that he was just sad that it was her performing, yeah. On the screen. Yeah, that made him very sad.
Poor Yuri.
You want to send us, you have any other ones you want to do to send us home, Amanda?
You can do this. No, I can't.
You got this. I believe in you. Wait, what's that one? Amanda, can you read that one there that's by Amanda TJ?
No. The best part about this movie is that when you buy the soundtrack, it's different singers. So it's like hours of bonus content where you can imagine your favorite musicians in the movie. 10 out of 10.
Great. I love how
would
you,
be a vampire.
You got Rotten Tomatoes to agree to let you do a 10-star rating system just for that one review.
They really respect me.
That's awesome.
I gotta say, all these reviews aside, apparently Robert Loggia was trying to stack the deck in Queen of the Damned's favor, because I have 1, 2, 3, 4 reviews on the same page from Robert Loggia, Robert L.
Oh my God.
Which is favorite vampire movie of all time, definitely 2 thumbs up, and it's the same thing each time.
Oh wow.
Shit,
I did actually find an interesting one.
Is he using different IP addresses every time?
No, just writing them on different dates. Let's
is
see.
That allowed?
I don't know. We got one from November 5th of 2014, October 28th of 2014, October 23rd of 2014.
He was just going through some shit.
July 3rd of 2014.
We are through the looking glass here, people.
Yeah. Rotten Tomatoes scores are propped up by Robert Loggia alone.
Robert Loggia.
He's like, Showgirls is better.
See my review for...
I found another 5-star one that just, even as someone who liked this, seemed odd. Smurfy C, 5-star rating. Truly an original and unique masterpiece.
Did you say unique and original?
Original and unique masterpiece.
I mean, I agree with masterpiece. No.
Obviously.
Wow. It's bold. But it's like, by definition, it's not original or unique.
Yeah. Yeah, because it's an adaptation.
Yeah.
And it's not even like they did something fun and quirky with it.
Yeah. This is no Warm Bodies. Come on. But yeah, that's Queen of the Damned. Those are the reviews.
Queen of the Damned.
Queen of the Damned, as they say now, the kids would say it these days, right?
Yes.
Yes, Queen of the Damned.
Yes, Queen of the Damned. So, Amanda, first of all, thank you very much for coming back once again.
Oh, thanks for having me.
Sorry again. Sorry it couldn't have been a better movie.
No, I was okay with this one.
I was going to say, I think you enjoyed watching this more than you did talking about cats.
Oh, yeah. Cats is just my nightmare.
Genital cats. Yeah, genital cats.
Nope.
Can't even joke about it. She's done with it.
I can't. I'm so done with that movie.
But Amanda, you have lots of stuff. So tell people where they can find you.
I do. You can primarily find me on YouTube under the name Amanda the Jedi, which has been going really well lately. But I also stream on Twitch at Amanda the Jedi, and you can find me on Instagram, Twitter, Letterboxd, and all of the above at the same name, Amanda the Jedi.
Okay. Are you on MySpace?
I wouldn't encourage people trying to find me there. Or else you might really understand the full level of my Queen of the Damned affection. I'm joking. I don't think there's anything
Amanda
there.
The vampire.
Honestly, though. I would have been Jesse. I would have been like, let's go, Coven. Except I was like 12, so it's different.
Wow.
Jesse's 35. Well, that was a good idea. Sorry.
Well, let's give a hint ski as to what's coming up next week.
Okay.
So, Nathan, why don't you give us a hint? Give us a hint of what we got coming up next week to continue Schlocktober.
Well, I actually, I was thinking I was going to defer this hint to a guest, actually. Okay. She's just going to come in real quick for this hint, and then she'll be gone because I think she's got a date afterwards.
Oh, cool.
So, with a guy who really likes shoes. So, let's hear it for our guest hint giver.
If you think Annabelle was bad, this is going to be way worse.
Thank you. Appreciate
Don't touch
you
me.
I won't. Milosh is out back waiting for you.
Never mind that.
I won't. I'll keep it on the DL. Thank you.
Well, there you go. That's what's coming up next week. Also, you can find us on all the podcatchers. We are on ageofradio.org. That is our new home, ageofradio.org/whatwerethinkingor, you know, just go to the website, click on the shows. You can also find us on all the other podcast apps as well. You can find us on Podbean, Stitcher, Spotify, all that good stuff. You can find us on Patreon, patreon.com/WWTT podcast. We're on Redbubble and I almost said Rebel. We're on Rebel Radio. We're on Redbubble and TeePublic. And we are also on Facebook. Just search for What Were They Thinking and you will find us. I promise you. That is my guarantee to you. Guarantee. Yeah, so, I mean, I guess before we get into the final moments here, once again, just reiterate thank you, Amanda the Jedi.
Thanks for having me.
For coming to
Thanks
this
for
podcast.
Being there for us there.
Thanks, babe.
Thanks, babe.
But, Nathan, as we close this out, do you have any questions?
I think I got a question or two I could lay on you here. I mean, okay, so... With a movie based on the works of a fairly popular author at the time, and with a movie where they clearly got the idea that, you know, the flash over substance was the way to go, and with a movie where, the name of the movie, kind of lets you think that the movie's going to be strictly about this Queen of the Damned, and with a movie where they get a top billing popular musical artist to play the titular role, and they only put her in it for 8 minutes, I simply have to ask.
Shoot.
What were they thinking?
The world is a vampire.
Hey, this is Liz.
And this is Heather.
And we are Nerdy Bitches Podcast,
a show where two geeky ladies podcast their way through pop culture.
From movies and TV to our regular book club and everything in between, we bring you our favorite fandoms with a feminine eye.
We're talking Star Wars, Star Trek, Harry Potter, DC, Marvel, comic books, and anime.
And don't forget sci-fi, fantasy, action movies, video games, D&D, board games, and so much more.
Be sure to check us out on Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Stitcher, Podbeam, or wherever you find awesome podcasts.
You can also find us hanging out on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, Pinterest, and at nerdybitches.com.
Talk to you soon.